Simon & Schuster Audio presents That Bonesetter Woman by Frances Quinn. Read by Sophie Roberts. Chapter 1. It's usual, they say, for a young person coming to London for the first time to arrive with a head full of dreams. Well, Endurance Proudfoot did not. When she stepped off the coach from Sussex on a warm and sticky afternoon in the summer of 1757, it never occurred to her that the city would be the place where she'd make her fortune. She was just very annoyed to be arriving there at all.
"We're here, Durie. We're in London," said her sister Lucinda, blue eyes sparkling, though London couldn't take credit for that. Barring the times when they filled with tears, real or otherwise, Lucinda's eyes always sparkled.
"Aren't you even a bit excited?"
"No," said Durie, and pointed out their bags to the coachman handing down the baggage from the roof. It had been a long day, 8 hours of bumping and jolting in the coach, 6 spent listening to a dumpling-faced woman who'd boarded with her husband at Uckfield and spent the journey pointing out things they could plainly see for themselves.
"That's a big oak tree. Here comes another coach. Lots of folk in Tunbridge today. That woman's got a pink bonnet on."
Until Durie began to think the people with cheap tickets, perched up behind the coachman, had the best of the situation. The husband answered each remark with a smile and a nod. Did he really not find her annoying at all, and entertained himself by watching the effect of the rutted roads on Lucinda's bosoms? The mystery of his tolerance was solved when, at last, they pulled up in the cobbled courtyard of the inn that was the coach's final destination, and his wife asked him whether he thought it might rain. On getting the usual nod and smile, she'd slapped his arm and said,
"You fool! You've sat with your deaf ear towards me again!"
Lucinda caught Durie's eye and winked, hoping to share a laugh at their expense. But Durie wasn't going to be got round that easily. It was Lucinda's fault they were there, when Durie had good reason to wish they weren't. And if Lucinda thought she was going to think of it as an adventure, like she'd said as they waited for the coach that morning, she could go and scratch. Durie had wondered if her sister's looks might be quite every day in London, but of course they weren't. With the biggest, bluest eyes you'd ever seen, skin like fresh cream, and thick curls that could have been actual gold spun into hair, she stood out even there. She was like a doll, and not any old doll, but one the doll maker had slaved over to make perfect, throwing away 2 or 3 versions before he got it just right. Even before their baggage was piled on the cobbles, she'd attracted admiring glances from 2 soldiers and a costermonger with a basket of apples on his head, who weren't to know that slender waist wouldn't be slender much longer. And now look at her, twinkling at a foppish-looking youth in a canary-yellow coat, who could have been just about anyone. A good job Durie was here, even if she didn't want to be, because otherwise, who knew what kind of trouble Lucinda might stroll into. She might, at 19, be 2 years older than Durie, but she didn't have the sense she was born with, and that couldn't have been a lot. A porter appeared.
"Carry your bags, girls."
"No, thank you, I can take them," said Durie.
"But could you direct us to South Audley Street?"
He looked at their baggage, and in particular the trunk their stepmother had packed with everything Lucinda would need in the coming months, and laughed.
"That's a good long walk. Call it 6 and I'll carry all this and show you the way."
"There's no need," said Durie, hefting up the trunk and balancing it against her shoulder, then picking up the bag with her free hand. The porter's mouth dropped open.
"Blimey, was your father a packhorse?" "Can you give us directions?" she said, "or shall I ask someone with a civil tongue in their head?"
He scowled, but told them the way, and he was right. It was a good long walk, which would have been fine at home, but the London streets were so busy. They made Lewes, even on market day, look like a little village. You couldn't move for hawkers and costermongers yelling out their wares.
In the first 100 yards alone, they had to dodge a rabbit cellar with 6 furry carcasses strung from a pole, a knife grinder's cart, and a woman carrying a basket piled high with silver salmon, bellowing that they were straight out of a river and waving one about for potential buyers to sniff. Not much room to get out of anyone's way, either, with carriages and carts trundling by, their wheels churning up clouds of dust and dirt from the dry streets and releasing the stench of horse muck to join the coal smoke hanging in the air. After a while, the streets got wider and smarter looking, with great long stretches of shops, the sun glinting off their windows. What could they all find to sell? People dawdled about like idiots, looking in the windows and pointing things out to each other. What with them and the hawkers, selling flowers and fripperies now, but just as numerous, and the carriages and carts, it was impossible to walk at any kind of a pace. Lucinda stopping to buy a posy of violets didn't help. She couldn't just pay for the stupid things. She had to chit-chat to the girl, and the last half a mile took as long as 2. By the time they arrived at their aunt's street, what with trying not to knock people into the road with the trunk, not entirely successfully, watching out for the pickpockets their father had warned were everywhere, and looking for street names to make sure they weren't lost, Dury was hot, sweaty, and thoroughly fed up. Lucinda, strolling along in her wake, now and then peering into a shop window, looked as though she'd just taken a dip in rose water. South Audley Street was blessedly quiet and empty after the streets full of shops. Houses on either side, not large but very smart-looking, with white-painted fronts, railings separating them from the street, well-scrubbed steps down to the basements and up to their shiny black doors, and troughs of scarlet geraniums on the windowsills. A couple of ragged-looking boys were sweeping the cobbles, and every window gleamed. "Nice," said Lucinda. "Our long-lost aunt must be doing well for herself." She looked at Dury, sighed, and took out a handkerchief. "Here, clean your face. You look like you've been digging a ditch. And cheer up. It'll be fun being here. You'll see." Before Dury could answer, the door was opened by a maid, and behind her appeared an older woman who had to be their aunt. She had their father's eyes, grey-blue and serious, the same sharp nose and iron-grey hair that made her look older than she could feasibly be in a forbiddingly tidy bun. "So you're here," she said, looking them up and down, her eyes pausing for a second at Dury's feet. "Well, you better come in." Dury put down the trunk and bag on the black and white tiles. What a relief to have a free arm to wipe her sweaty neck. "It's very kind of you to have us, Aunt Ellen," said Lucinda, giving her aunt the full force of her dimples and handing over the flowers. "These are for you. I hope we won't be too much trouble."
"I hope so too," said Aunt Ellen, without giving the posy a glance. "And kindness didn't come into it. Your father said there was nowhere else for you to go. Now take your things upstairs. Your room's on the right."
She walked off down the hallway, light footsteps clicking on the tiles. Lucinda and Dury exchanged glances. "Welcome to my home," muttered Lucinda.
"Then come down and we'll have some tea," Aunt Ellen called over her shoulder, "and I'll tell you how things are going to be while you're here."
"Old cow," said Lucinda when they got upstairs. "You'd think she'd be glad of the company, living on her own."
"Perhaps she likes living on her own," said Dury, dropping the bags and flopping down on the bed. "I wouldn't mind it."
"What, be a sad old maid, with people feeling sorry for you? No, thank you."
Dury couldn't see much to feel sorry for. The bedchamber might be smaller than their room at home, the window looking out onto a little yard behind instead of a garden, but probably houses had to be that way in London, with so many people to cram in, and the quality of the furnishings and the smartness of the street told their own story. Their aunt kept a shop, their father had said, her own business entirely, and if that had paid for a house like this, with no husband on hand, it was quite impressive. Lucinda peered into the dressing-table mirror, tweaking one golden curl so it sat perfectly, and smiled at herself.
"Did you see how that gentleman in the carriage looked at me as he passed?" she said. "I think I'm going to enjoy London."
"Oh well, good for you," said Dury, who hadn't seen the gentleman in question, but didn't need to. "I'm going to miss all the summer carriage accidents. You know that, don't you? It'll be autumn before we go back."
"Who says I'm going back?" said Lucinda. "When this is all done with, I might find myself a husband in London, a rich one."
"I think you'll find they've already got someone in mind for the Prince of Wales." Lucinda shrugged.
"Plenty of dukes left." "Oh, honestly."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.